What is the Schomburg Center? To me, it is home. The place where we come to see who we really are, not just somebody else's reflection of who we are.
The Schomburg Center is a place of culture. It's a place of history. It's a place of knowledge.
The Schomburg Center, to me, is a repository of all of the things that has documented our sense of worth as a people.
For me, that means that it is a place of immense power.
The Schomburg Center is a public research library and a cultural institution.
For the study of the Pan-African world,
it is perhaps the best in the world.
My Schomburg Center is Arturo Alfonso Schomburg.
Arturo Schomburg said, Black history and culture and intellect exists at a time when most people didn't believe that. He collected those evidences, and that became the beginning of the collection.
And it has expanded and has grown to where it is now a world-class institution.
It holds over 10 million items.
There's no parallel anywhere that brings to light what we as people of color have done, what we continue to do.
Black culture is all of culture. The universals that animate everyone's life happen here. For all people.
The Schomburg for me is one of the center pillars of Harlem. When I started the journey of finding out about Red Rooster and Harlem, the very first place I went to was the Schomburg.
Researchers from around the world come and use what we have here.
I could not have written just about any of the books that I've written without the Schomburg Center's archives, resources.
The Schomburg Center is much more than a library. We encourage lifelong learning and exploration.
The Junior Scholars Program is a Saturday program with students from fifth grade to senior year in high school to help them learn about Black history and culture.
Learning about my history is important because it teaches me who I am.
The Schomburg Junior Scholars Program is going to do nothing but uplift them.
So many talented and brilliant people have walked the corridors of this amazing institution over the years. From Octavia Butler to Toni Morrison and James Baldwin, Ella Fitzgerald, Alvin Ailey, and Harry Belafonte, who graced the stage in this room of the American Negro Theater.
This place evokes great memories. It was a gift to us in our community to really try to find that space to reflect expressions of Black experience. I just knew that the environment, what I saw these young African Americans doing, was a place I needed to be.
What is my Schomburg Center? I'm standing here at the Cosmogram, which underneath holds the ashes of the poet Langston Hughes. On the evening when this Cosmogram was dedicated, people began to empty out of the auditorium. A jazz trio struck up. And to my amazement, Amira Baraka went over and asked Maya Angelou for a dance. And they started to dance on top of the Cosmogram, on top of the ashes of Langston Hughes. And I felt what a fitting way to kiss the memory of Langston.
The Schomburg Center is a research institute and a library, but it's so much more than that.
There's something going on every day.
So many amazing people come here to talk about their creative craft, to share what inspires them. The Schomburg Center's collections help to tell stories even beyond our walls.
The Schomburg Center is here in this exhibition at MoMA, One Way Ticket, Jacob Lawrence's migration series. We depend on the resources of the Schomburg to enable us to tell this story. Thinking about the implications of the past on the present is absolutely crucial for understanding the next steps, understanding what we have to do to go forward.
We today have the responsibility of making sure that new artists and activists, new scholars and poets know that this place continues to be a resource and a source of inspiration for the work that we must continue to do.
The Schomburg Center is knowledge.
The Schomburg Center, to me, is education.
The Schomburg Center is home. It is family. It is foundational.
The Schomburg Center is inspiration.
The Schomburg is with me in everything that I do.
Community, inside and out.
The Schomburg Center is us.
The Schomburg Center is you. And we invite each and every one of you to find your Schomburg Center.
Good evening. I haven't even said anything, and you guys are clapping already. I love it. I love it. Welcome to the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, and welcome to Women's History Month. My name is Joy Bivens, and I have the distinct privilege of serving as the director of this historic institution. And it's my pleasure to welcome you here tonight and to introduce this next edition of Conversations in Black Freedom Studies. I know many of you are regulars here at Schomburg, but for those of you who may be with us for the first time, we are a public research library committed to collecting, preserving, and sharing materials that reflect the global Black experience. And in that work, we are intentional about lifting up the narratives of women. And as we approach our centennial, 100 years, y'all, in 2025, we are mindful of the impact that women leaders have had on this institution, including the first Black and Spanish-speaking women librarians who worked here at the height of the Harlem Renaissance. Those are Catherine Latimer and Pura Belpre, but also the first director of the Schomburg Center, Ms. Jean Blackwell Hudson. Tonight's program, Black Women, Freedom Making, and the Long 1960s, is a dynamic way to begin this month of celebrating women's history. The next voices you will hear will be those of the series co-curators, Drs. Jean Theo Harris and Robin Spencer Antoine, and they'll introduce tonight's scholars. And I want to tell you a little bit about Dr. Theo Harris and Dr. Spencer Antoine. Dr. Theo Harris, Jean Theo Harris, is one of the co-founders of Conversations in Black Freedom Studies. She is a distinguished scholar who focuses on civil rights and Black power movements and the contemporary politics of race in the United States. She is author of the widely acclaimed biography, I have a little something in my throat tonight, The Rebellious Life of Mrs. Rosa Parks. And her award-winning book has been adapted into a young adult edition and a documentary for NBC Peacock. And side note, I had Professor Theo Harris as a senior and at the University of Michigan many moons ago, not that long ago, but many moons ago. And Dr. Robin Spencer Antoine is a historian whose teaching and research explore Black social protests after the Second World War, urban and working class radicalism, and gender. She is the author of The Revolution Has Come, Black Power, Gender, and the Black Panther Party in Oakland, which was published in 2016. I want to thank our featured speakers for contributing their voices to this discussion tonight, and I want to thank all of you for joining us either here in person or online. As always, I have a couple of notes for you. Please, no flash photography. And if you could refrain from filming the program, we archive everything. So if you want to see this again, you can find it online at schomburg.org. And please turn off your cell phone ringer so that you don't interrupt and your fellow audience members or the presenters. Those are my pet peeves for this evening. And I want to thank you for being with us. And I hope you enjoy the program. And again, welcome back. Or welcome to the Schomburg Center. Thank you.
Good evening. Oh, it's so great to be here. This is our 11th season of Conversations in Black Freedom Studies. Kamosi Woodard and I started this series, Conversations in Black Freedom Studies, more than a decade ago in concert with the Schomburg Center to create a space where the public could engage with new works in Black freedom movement history. With bookstores closing and fewer public spaces to engage with new work in Black history, Conversations was conceived as a way to hear, to learn, to discuss, to think together about this new work in Black history that helps us see the present more clearly. We are so very pleased that the Schomburg Center has continued this series as one of its educational and public programming offerings, and grateful to the many people at the Schomburg, Joy Bivens, Casey Matthews, Lisa Herndon, Park Boulevard, and many others who make this series possible. We are grateful for Lucien Baskin, who is our outreach and social media coordinator. Please follow us at Schomburg CBFS or at our website, blackfreedomstudies.org. Our next conversation, because obviously conversations is always first Thursday of the month, but we now toggle between being in the building and online. So our next conversation, Thursday, April 4th, will be back online, and we'll be focusing on food, life, and leisure with Blair Kelly, Teresa Runstetler, Bobby J. Smith II, and Ava Perkis. Tonight, we are especially pleased to be back in person in this historic building and to have Kamozi Woodard back front and center, along with Robin Spencer Antoine, who joined us as a curator 3 years ago. Welcome.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to our conversation. I'm Robin Spencer Antoine. It's such a pleasure to be here with you tonight. This conversation feels especially urgent. Considering the role of Black women in freedom making in the United States is something that we are all gathered here to do this evening, and I'm excited to get us started. We're delighted to be together for this timely conversation at a new moment of political organizing and uprising, and of course, in Women's History Month. That has been the goal of conversations from its beginnings 11 years ago, the history we need to see the way forward, and tonight feels even more urgent than ever, and it's such a pleasure to be with you in person, and greetings to everyone who is joining us from the larger world. I'm delighted and honored to introduce tonight's panelists. Their books are available in the Schomburg shop online if you are joining us online, as well as in Harlem. Authors will be available after the talk if you have any further comments to make to them. I want to start by introducing Dr. Suzanne Cope. Dr. Suzanne Cope is a narrative journalist and professor at New York University, whose recent book is Power Hungry: Women of the Black Panther Party and Freedom Summer, and their fight to feed a movement. Dr. Cope. Next, we have Dr. Anastasia Curwood, Hallam Professor and Chair of History, Director of Commonwealth Institute for Black Studies at the University of Kentucky, and author of Shirley Chisholm, Champion of Black Feminist Power Politics. Dr. Curwood. And last but not least, we have Dr. Christina Greene, professor in the Department of African American Studies and a faculty affiliate in the History Department and Gender and Women's Studies Department at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and the author of Free Joan Little: The Politics of Race, Sexual Violence, and Imprisonment. Let's put our hands together for everyone and come on out, Dr. Greene.
At this moment, at this urgent moment, as Robin was reminding us. So we wanted to start sort of where you started. Give us a sense of how you got to this topic, what experiences or research led you to this topic of your most recent book. And Suzanne, let's start with you.
Sure. It was late 2016, and I had put together this great book proposal that did not get sold, and Ellen Quinn's story was within this proposal. I was really thinking about so much activism was happening at the end of that year, and I was deeply immersed in food studies at the time, and I saw colleagues, people in who I knew, groups I knew of, and they were feeding protesters, they were having immigrants and refugees cook to raise money and to raise awareness. And I thought, what is this history of food as a tool for social and political change? And so I did this deep dive, and I found five stories from about the last 80 years or so that were about highlighting these unsung women at the time. That book, like I said, didn't sell. The feedback was, we want American stories. So I took the one story, which was Ellen Quinn's story that was set in the United States, and I turned that into a book proposal. But because these women had, for so long, their lives had been, you know, much lesser documented than a lot of their male peers, I was afraid that I wouldn't have enough to fill an entire book, even though I knew her story was so urgent. And you know, talking with my agent, we came across, she's like, why don't you think about the Black Panther Party and the free breakfast program? And I thought, oh, isn't this a story that's been told? And I did even a little bit of scholarly research, and I realized how wrong I was. And I was connected with Cleo Silvers pretty quickly, and she was so wonderful and generous. And I realized how much of this story was left to be told. And so this turned into a dual narrative that was thematically connected. And what was amazing and surprising when I started to dive deeper into the research process is that there's actually moments where these two stories do intersect, which was unexpected and wonderful. So I'm really excited about this dual narrative and how these stories came together in the end.
Wonderful. Well, I first thought about this project in some way in about 1980 or thereabouts. So it took me a really long time to write it. And yes, I was a child in 1980. I saw a photograph of my parents with this very glamorous Black woman. I thought she was my father's sister, because my aunt also was very glamorous. And I said, is that Auntie Sally? And my parents said, no, that's Shirley Chisholm. She ran for president. Someday you could too. So I filed that away in my little six-year-old brain, and I did decide not to run for president.
Excellent choice.
Although I had my picture taken at the desk in the New York Historical Society today. There's an Opal office replica. But I just had that in my mind, and then I became a historian, and then I got interested in Black women's biography, and then I was teaching a course on Black women's biography, and I looked for a biography of Chisholm and couldn't find one, except for young people's books, children's books. And that was the moment. So that was over 15 years ago. It really did take me a long time to write this.
Well, I'm old enough to remember the Joanne Little case. I actually went to a rally here in New York City. I was young, but I went to a rally. I think, thinking back on it, it was probably her extradition case, and I'll talk briefly about that later. But also, I've been writing and researching and teaching about women's activism and Black women's activism as well, and Joanne Little case appears briefly in the epilogue to my first book, and I was curious about the activism that arose around her case, and specifically I was interested in the anti-rape activism. I didn't know about the prison activism that also was instrumental in her case, and that was something that I discovered. Another thing that was interesting when I Joanne Little was very generous and spent about 10 years. I took 17 years to write my book, so, you know. over a 10-year period, we would meet periodically, and she made an offhand comment in one of our meetings about a police officer who said to her, I'm going to get you. And she had been arrested numerous times, largely for petty theft, and almost all of the charges except for one were dismissed, and the one that stuck, I think she got 6 months probation. She was a teenager. And I had no way of knowing whether or not that really happened, but it sort of, you know, I said, wait a minute, that's interesting. And so what I did was I investigated a whole other story about Joanne Little from the time she was a teenager, and her encounters with the criminal legal system, which was much more typical than the more celebrated rape murder trial that some of you may know about. And so lots of things sort of went into this book, starting with, I think, probably going to a rally when I was a young person here in New York City on her behalf.
Wow, thank you for sharing that. Yeah. I would really love this to be a teaching moment for all of us here. I would love for each of you to give us a window into your work, and I say window metaphorically, but also because I know that you all have some wonderful visual images for us to think about and to think alongside of you with. So I wanted you to bring us into the world of your book and help us understand how Black women in the history that you have written push for imagined and achieved measures of justice and self-determination. And I think I'd love to invite Anastasia to take the podium and throw us in.
Thank you so much, Robin. And it's a little bit overwhelming for me to be here because I agree with Eric Foner. I could not have written either of the two books that I've written without the Schomburg Center. Both of them have provided priceless help for my work. And so thank you to the staff of the Schomburg, to my hosts. So the myth of, I'm gonna tell you a little bit about the mythology and the reality of Shirley Chisholm. And they're not entirely separate, but there is a distinction. So the myth is unbought and unbossed, no compromises, tough, outspoken. Outspoken's right, tough's right too. But this is the image that hangs in the US Capitol. The congresswomen of color who joined the Capitol, who joined Congress in 2019, took their photos with it. But the reality is that she's human. And as I wrote in the introduction to my book, it's hard to demystify our heroes, but we need to see them as human so that the humans of the future can see themselves as heroes. That there's not, she had singular, but not superhuman traits. She had a lot of ambition. I could have called the book Aim High. She was nothing if not ambitious. She was a dancer. And so you see her at the West Indian Day Parade in 1980. She was a highly original thinker. And the image that we imagine doesn't have her talking. The image of her as a human being is actually as a brilliant theorist. And I wound up following this thread through her life and discovered a pattern of her actions, her thoughts, her visions of freedom that I called Black feminist power politics. And what I said in the book, I call it this vantage point across categories of identity that locate common points of intersection with common interests and bringing those points to bring pressure on the present configurations of power. What it means is that everybody is distinctive. And this is something that critics of critical race theory, divisive concepts, et cetera, at this moment get wrong. Intersectionality does not divide people, it pulls people together. And in her case, she would see these points of common interest, like poor people who could be from many, many backgrounds, and then pull them together in a campaign, as she did in 1972. So she did this, I traced this through her whole life. As a child and a young person, she idolized her father, who is on our right in that image, and that's Chisholm at her first wedding in 1949. She was raised by her mother, who's sitting down, who was modeled being a very resolute though much quieter than her daughter, woman. Her father was an FDR Democrat and labor union activist, also a Marcus Garvey follower, member of the UNIA. And she learned at the feet of these people. She also learned from her grandmother. She was raised for 6 years of her life in Barbados by her Barbadian grandmother. And her grandmother taught her to be fearless, as well as to speak her mind. And then she became a teacher. Here she is in a leadership position that she took in downtown on this island of Manhattan at the Hamilton Madison Child Care Center. And as a teacher, she was directly observing the lives of her students, especially the young students, early childhood classes that she had. And she also then would get connected to their housing issues. So she became involved in tenant rights, and that was her first move into politics. But pretty quickly, she became involved with insurgent democratic organizations. And she was involved in an effort that was part of a political realignment or a political revision in Brooklyn that brought many more people of color into power in local democratic politics. So she was there at the right place at the right time. She supported the right people at the right time. And eventually, she got elected to the New York State Assembly in 1964. She was the inheritor of the leader of the Unity Democratic Club in Bed-Stuy in Brooklyn. And I call your attention to her autograph here. It says, "Always aim high." And it's signed, here it's signed Congresswoman Chisholm, because she actually wrote this autograph when she was in Congress. But the photograph is of her in the New York State Assembly. And she represented Bedford-Stuyvesant in Brooklyn, the 17th Assembly District. And while she was in the State Assembly, she was advocating for expanded abortion rights or a liberalization of abortion laws. Minimum wage and worker protections for domestic workers, like her mother had been. And she also had her eye on Congress. So she got to the US Congress after a really exciting congressional race in 1968. So if you think back to 1968, this is the moment, this is the year in which it all happened. Multiple assassinations, the election of Richard Nixon for the first time. It's a moment of inflection. Where does the country go from here? And for Shirley Chisholm, it happened to be, well, she went to Washington. But she's also, as a relatively unknown political figure, she's just referred to as woman in this New York Times story. She was up against James Farmer, who at that point was a famous civil rights activist, had been the leader of CORE, and had moved to Manhattan and was commuting across the bridge to campaign in Brooklyn. Well, she won, and in part, it was because she advocated an intersectional argument. She was going to not only run in the black neighborhoods in Bed-Stuy, but she also went to Jewish neighborhoods and gathered women together. So this was, and this would be sort of a signature of hers, to create a coalition of black people and women. And in her case, also, she was running on the Democratic Party ticket. Farmer was running on the Republican and Liberal Party tickets. Yes, he was running as a Republican. And we can talk about that later. She won. So she went to Congress. And in Congress, she quickly became a bit of a lightning rod. First of all, she hired an interracial group of women in her office. Her legislative aide was a woman. Her chief of staff was a woman. Her secretary was a woman. Everybody, they were all women. This is unheard of. And then she's the only woman among the early Congressional Black Caucus members. This is actually the Democratic Select Committee. It was the precursor to the Congressional Black Caucus. And as in Congress, she started giving speeches against the Vietnam War, against the seniority system of committee placements, for childcare. She almost got universal childcare passed in 1971 with the help of Bella Abzug. But she also attracted some attention, and among the groups that she spoke to in her travels were students, Black women, those who wanted her to run for president. And so she did. So she traveled the United States. She campaigned most heavily in California, North Carolina, Massachusetts, Florida. Here she is in Massachusetts. This is the image that I saw as a child. So my dad is the guy laughing, and my mother is the woman who's looking to the side next to him. And then there's Ms. Chisholm running for president in Boston. And you can see the coalition that she pulled together there. My parents were a biracial couple. They found their people in the campaign. And this is something that she was able to recruit a much wider group of people than somebody who was not an intersectional person in her very body, like Chisholm was. So the point of the presidential campaign was to make a coalition, to bring people together at the Democratic National Convention in 1972. And that was the last convention where the outcome for the presidential campaign was not actually certain. She did not win the presidency. That's not too much of a spoiler, I hope. But she was in Congress for 10 more years. And so when we think about Chisholm as this symbolic candidate for president, we forget about the 10 years that she spent in Congress after that, advocating for, again, minimum wage for domestic workers nationwide, for bilingual education. She wound up on the Rules Committee, which was the most powerful committee in the House, well, maybe besides Ways and Means. She also then retired from Congress and founded the National Black Women's Political Congress. And in that capacity, here they are throwing a 75th birthday party for Rosa Parks. You can see Coretta Scott King, you can see Dorothy Height, you can see Dolores Tucker. That organization mentored people like Donna Brazil, who was an executive director, like Maxine Waters, Barbara Lee, of course. So she had an 80-year life, and we thought we knew her, and we still think we know her. This is a famous quote: if they don't give you a seat at the table, bring a folding chair. How many of you have heard that? Okay, everybody, right? So I cannot find any evidence of where she said that. I have read all of her speeches. I've read her articles. The only place I know where she might have said it is to Donna Brazil, her mentee, in the National Political Congress of Black Women. And, you know, Donna Brazil, I haven't had a chance to talk to her. It sounds like something Chisholm would have said. And actually, I embrace it. It embodies the spirit of Shirley Chisholm. And so, you know, why not? Thank you.
Thank you all for being here. I want to thank Robin and Jean for the invitation. Your work has informed mine. Your groundbreaking, pathbreaking work has been really terrific. And of course, Kamosi's work has informed my work too. So, and I also want to thank the people behind the scenes who put together events like this. I used to do stuff like this, and I know it takes a lot of hands. So I'm going to, what you'll see behind me are just some images from the book and from my research. I'm going to read just a little bit from the introduction to Free Joanne Little, just to give you a sense of what the book is about. And these are just some images that you'll see on the screen as I'm reading. In the early hours of August 27, 1974, prison officials found the jailer, Clarence Alligood, slumped on a bunk in the women's section of the Beaufort County Jail in eastern North Carolina. His lifeless body bore 11 stab wounds, including 7 in his chest and 1 that pierced his heart. Naked from the waist down, except for his brown socks, Alligood clutched his trousers in one hand, an ice pick dangled loosely from the other. A trail of dried semen trickled down his left thigh. His shoes were in the narrow hallway outside the jail cell. A negligee and bra hung on the cell door. The prisoner, Joanne Little, was nowhere in sight. She was 5'3" tall, 20 years old, poor, black, and in trouble. He was white, 62 years old, and at 200 pounds, nearly twice her size. On these facts, both sides would agree. Those who believe Joanne Little was guilty saw a hardened criminal with the instincts of a black widow spider, a Jezebel who lured the unsuspecting Alligood into her cell with promises of sex. In the moment of his climax, the wanton young woman ruthlessly stabbed and killed the poor, defenseless man. On the other side, feminists of all kinds, black power activists, prison abolitionists, black churching class, black working class, church women, and traditional civil rights leaders saw a victim of sexual violence and racism, a vulnerable black woman who had valiantly defended herself against one of the age-old and unforgivable crimes of white supremacy. Although they would differ among themselves about whether sexism, racism, or poverty was most salient, her defenders all discerned a young woman, destitute, alone, and terrified at her predicament, who did what any trapped victim would do, defended herself, and then fled in a panic. Little remained on the lam for less than a week. Officials invoked a Reconstruction-era fugitive law that allowed anyone to shoot and kill the young woman on sight. With the assistance of a local attorney, some subterfuge involving a wig, mistaken identities, and a nerve-wracking trip in the dead of night, Little made her way to Chapel Hill, about 2 hours away, where a multiracial group of about a dozen women and men anxiously awaited Little's arrival. From that gathering, the Free Joanne Little campaign was born. The next day, Little, surrounded by her attorneys and supporters, turned herself in to the authorities in Raleigh. It took no time for a Beaufort County grand jury to indict her for first-degree murder. If convicted, Joanne would face a mandatory death sentence in North Carolina's gas chamber. After a 5-week trial in August of 1975, a majority female jury composed equally of black and white jurors, found Joanne Little not guilty. Joanne Little's troubles, however, did not end with her acquittal on the murder charge. Several months later, she lost her appeal on the 1974 felony theft convictions that had landed her in the Beaufort County Jail in the first place. The triumphant defendant in the rape murder trial returned to women's prison in Raleigh to serve a 7 to 10 year and possible 14 to 20 year sentence. Denied parole several times, she was depressed, desperate, and sure she was being railroaded. So one day in October 1977, Joanne scaled the 10-foot fence at women's prison in Raleigh, North Carolina, and headed north. 2 months later, a former boyfriend tipped off the New York police concerning Joan's whereabouts. A high-speed chase through the streets of Brooklyn by New York's finest ensued, and Joanne and a male friend were apprehended. She was sent to Rikers Island, the city's notorious jail, to await a hearing on her extradition to North Carolina. And she presumably met Asada Shakur, some of you may know, who was also imprisoned. Asada was at that point a member of the Black Liberation Army and then eventually had to flee into exile in Cuba. By June 1978, Joanne Little had lost her extradition fight in New York and was on her way back to women's prison, handcuffed and shackled with waist chains for the trip back to North Carolina. She received an additional 6 months to 2 years prison time for the escape, was paroled in 1979, and was forced to leave the state. The Joanne Little case is a story of race, sexual violence, and criminal punishment in the South, a tale so hauntingly familiar it resonates across 400 years of American history. But this was not simply a Southern tale. It reverberated across the Mason-Dixon line with the national implications that were every bit as important. Joanne Little never wanted to become a cause celeb, although she was far more politically astute than either her advocates or critics acknowledged. She drew national attention because activists understood that her murder-rape trial reflected the complex cross-currents surrounding racial and sexual politics in the 1970s. Perhaps most important, the case was a commentary on the historic sexual abuse of Black women. That Joanne was a woman in captivity evoked the bitter truth about slavery. An enslaved woman's body was never her own. But in the mid-1970s, there was also a case study of a woman's right to defend herself, even to kill her assailant when threatened with sexual assault. The trial had other racial and sexual ramifications as well, shining a spotlight on a criminal legal system that imprisoned disproportionate numbers of impoverished African Americans and that posed special dangers of sexual vulnerability for Black women. The Little case also drew attention to the narrow legal definition of rape and to the underrepresentation of women and Black men on juries, and it became a testimonial against the racially discriminatory use of the death penalty. Centering African American women in historical narratives about prison organizing and anti-rape activism in the 1970s, which is one of the things that I discovered and that I focus the book on, is really about how that case inspires a broad range of activism throughout not just the 1970s, but into the 1980s and even 1990s. But by centering Black women's activism in this period, around prison organizing and anti-rape activism, we really see a more expansive definition of political prisoners and political engagement. Black women's activism, including Black feminism, also calls for a more nuanced understanding of the various streams of women's liberation. Rooted in the long arc of African American women's protest traditions, Black women from the 1960s to the 1980s were both a part of and apart from the more visible women's liberation movements of those years. Far from the declension narrative that until recently has shaped most histories of so-called second wave feminism, which frequently concentrated on white middle-class women outside the South, or the popular notion that Black women remained absent from the women's anti-rape movement, African-American women and other women of color found new outlets for their struggles against sexual violence. Similarly, accounts of prison organizing during these years have highlighted uprisings in men's prison and the headline-grabbing news of radical Black men. Too often, incarcerated women have either been ignored or dismissed as largely apolitical and unorganized. Yet women, too, fought their own carceral battles on both sides of the prison walls, and they were also instrumental in providing assistance to men's prison protests. And very often, they combined these things. So, for example, Black women at the Washington, D.C. Rape Crisis Center also were involved in prison activism and a whole host of other community issues that were particularly important to the Black community. One of the other things that I discovered was that the National Black Women's Health Network, started by Black feminist and health activist Billy Avery in the early 1980s, was also an anti-rape organization. One of the things that Avery discovered in traveling around the country and organizing workshops for Black women was that violence particularly and very often sexual violence, was the number one issue that black women wanted to talk about. So Free Joanne Little, then, is not a biography of Joanne Little, per se. Rather, it is an account of how the racial and gender politics of the 1970s and 80s collided with a young black woman in Eastern North Carolina in the last quarter of the 20th century, in crafting a more inclusive history of this period that centers the experiences and organizing efforts of African American women in particular. We may find lessons for the organizing for the ongoing struggles against racialized sexual violence and imprisonment in our own century. Thank you.
Hello. We're going to go back to the 1960s. But first, I want to thank Robin and Jean and everyone here. I am just honored to be on this stage. I have seen events here. I've brought students here. I've done research here at this amazing center. So thank you all for having me. All right. So as I noted, this is a dual biography, but it's also, like these other books, it's so much more. It's about these movements that these women were helping to feed. And so you'll see Eileen Quinn at the top, and Cleo is among those women in the lower picture. So first I'll start talking about Eileen Quinn. She lived in Macomb, Mississippi, which John Dittmer was kind of the historian of the Black Civil Rights Movement in Macomb and the Voting Rights Movement during this time. And he said that the story of Macomb is the story of the fight for Black independence in Mississippi. And Mississippi, Macomb was also called one of the worst towns in perhaps the worst state in the United States for civil rights. And so this was a really difficult and important fight. Eileen was not born in Macomb. She was born nearby, and she moved there. And she was the owner of South of the Border, which was a tavern and restaurant. And this was one of the few businesses that a woman could actually have, could be an expert in. They could cook, and perhaps they could own a beauty shop. She was a single mom to four kids. Only two were living with her during this time, and this motel she would open up later, probably in the 1970s. But I love this picture of her. She's the taller woman on my left. She was elegant. Her daughter told me how she would always have her clothes tailored for her and handmade. And if you could see it a little bit better, you could see these women look like they're having a great party. So she was very active in voting rights efforts in Macomb. She had been registered where she lived before. She was also active in the NAACP in Macomb. And so I think of her very much as this activist mother, and borrowing this phrase from Dr. Francois Hamlin, who used it in a book that she was writing also about another activist in Mississippi, Vera Mae Pidgey, who was instrumental in the Delta, working against the Greenwood food blockade. And this also helps us think about food as a weapon or a tool for both oppression and also for supporting people. So the Greenwood food blockade, very briefly, was a moment when the Black power or the white power structure, they blocked food aid to hungry, starving, impoverished sharecroppers mostly, and this was done for the most part, believed to be because they were trying to register to vote. And so it was Vera Mae Pidgey who helped get the youth involved, who helped get all these celebrities involved. Harry Belafonte, who was mentioned in that beginning sequence, he was instrumental in this, and they sent all this food, and they got all this interest so that this was stopped from happening in the future, and also they fed these hungry people. And so this concept of activist mothering, of these women who would use these female skills these things that the skills and leadership that are often forgotten, that, you know, how to feed people, how to support the youth, thinking about nourishment and a roof over your head. These are concepts that are kind of considered women's work and are often disregarded. And so I love this concept of activist mothering, and it really, once I discovered it, it really drove what I was thinking both about Eline and also about Cleo and all the women that they were working with. So the book mostly focuses on freedom, or at least the story of Eline mostly focuses on Freedom Summer of 1964. Of course, there was a lot that that led into this. So you'll see that top picture of the gentleman is Robert Paris Moses, who is a New Yorker. And he came to Macomb actually the year before, in 1963. And he wanted to see what the people wanted. He was part of SNCC. And so he came and said, what can we come and support you with? And the people said, voting rights. And he brought it back to SNCC, and SNCC said, this is too hard. We have to get we have to get literacy up. We have to get people to pass the poll test. It's dangerous. And he said, no, this is what I want to do. And he found Macomb was a very hospitable place with activists who were willing to take that extreme risk. I mean, people were killed and injured and arrested for this. And then below him is C.C. Bryant, who was another local leader with Eileen Quinn. And so she was unique because she was one of perhaps the only female community leader who was both active with the women. She was part of the PTA. She, she had young kids, and she was also active with the business leaders. So she kind of had the ear of a lot of people and was seen as a real force in the community. And so she would feed everyone. So now we have the power of food to bring people together. And she, if you were a SNCC activist during '64, and also with folks who came before then, you could go to south of the border and she would feed you, no questions asked. Curtis Mays, Hayes Muhammad has said, our money was no good there. And she would feed you if you were white or black. She would bring food to the COFO houses where they were helping to teach kids in freedom schools. And this was very upsetting to the white power structure, who did not like the fact that food was bringing people together over the table. And so she also did an interesting story with some of these activists who were jailed after supporting students who were walked out because they were supporting a classmate who was arrested for a sit-in at the local bus terminal, Brenda Travis. And she would bring food to the jails. And they, I wrote this down. So we have Robert Moses wrote that that she would bring rice and gravy with bread to sop it up, and big town cake that I think is like a moon pie. And one of the folks that were jailed with him, he actually gained weight because they brought so much good food. And you could just imagine the smell in this jailhouse, and they were certainly eating better than the jailers were. And this was the point. You had an entire community who was supporting you, who was feeding you. And also, because these women were not considered political, were not considered active, they were helping to plan things with these activists. They would let them hang out for a little bit, and then they would bring this back to the freedom schools they were running, the information, they would pass information back and forth. So it was this very powerful moment where they were using the fact that they were disregarded to show and exercise their power. I should stick back here for one more second. This other photo is, actually Eileen was so powerful, was so targeted, that amidst all of these, there was many bombings. Macomb was called the bombing capital of the world. This tiny town, it is a small town. And her house was targeted with her children inside. Her children were okay. And it was this horrific moment. This was in the beginning of September, near the end of Freedom Summer, and all of her neighbors came out, and it was almost ready to start a riot. They were just so incensed that these bombings had gone on and gone on. And she was called upon to quell this unrest. She actually later would, a couple days later, NAACP took her, C.C. Bryant's wife, and another woman to meet President Johnson. And that was the moment where he somewhat grudgingly ordered the FBI to actually try and make these bombings stop. So she had this power in her community. interesting moment of these stories coming together. That's Father Earl Neal, who is known for helping to start the Free Breakfast for Children program with the Black Panther Party. He actually stayed in this house a couple days after it was bombed. I didn't know this until deep into the writing, but he had come to help support the voting rights efforts, and there weren't a lot of places for people to stay. Aline was still staying in her house, and he has some harrowing stories of his week in and around Macomb. The other image is the Black Panther of the Lowndes County, Alabama, which is another voting rights effort that inspired the Black Panther Party. And so I just wanted to help make the link between the two stories. So I won't go into the birth of the Black Panther Party right now, but Father Earl Neal, he was called upon by the Panthers in 1968. They said, "We really want to serve the community. Help us think about." I'm not very good with the PowerPoint. I like to just talk. Help us think about how to serve the community. And so he helped connect to people in Oakland. And so that's kind of where my story with Cleo and the Black Panthers come in. So here is wonderful Cleo Silvers, who served in the New York area. She's from Philadelphia. And that I love this picture of her as a kid, because I think it shows her absolutely ebullient nature. And so she was also part of the VISTA program that was here in New York. And so she, like what some of the previous stories we heard, she was really active in some of the issues around New York. So she was aware of housing issues, and she was helping with the kids in the school. And so she was actually recruited to join the Black Panther Party. And so this is the address of the Harlem branch, which is not too far from here. It is now a bodega, I think, halfway down the block, a mid-block bodega. That's very strange. But I love that it's there, and I sent her a picture when I walked by trying to find that address. She said, "There it is," but she remembers joining them, and she was thrilled to join them. And if you were part of the Black Panther Party, you were part of their survival programs. And so a lot of people think that the survival programs came out of, or I should say the narrative goes that they came out of this desire by the Black Panthers to kind of counter that image of violent young men with guns slung on their back, like came out of Oakland. But really, of the 10-point plan, I mean, this had always been part of how they wanted to serve the community. And actually, 2/3 of the Panthers were women. And so these women were instrumental in leading these survival programs. So the Free Breakfast for Children program began, like I mentioned, with some help from Father Earl Neal in Oakland. It was actually at the very end of 68, beginning of 69, and it spread all over the country very quickly. It became very popular. But anyone who could imagine feeding, say, 20 kids on a daily basis knows that this is a lot of coordination. This is a lot of work. And this is a lot of typically women's work, right? Who knows how long it takes bacon to cook, how much food you need to feed these kids, when you need to start cooking. And so women were very instrumental in running these programs, organizing these programs, not just the Free Breakfast program, but these other survival programs. And I know these are mostly or pretty much all pictures of men. And I asked Cleo about that, and she said, first of all, we were too busy working to have our picture taken. And also, talking to her and others, it seemed that there were often, not so much staged, but people liked this juxtaposition of these young men in the apron feeding the kids. But I tried to actually find other pictures of women, and other than the one that's on the cover of my book, I couldn't find a lot, including Cleo doesn't have one of her in the breakfast program either. So this breakfast program was so powerful because they weren't just feeding kids. They were giving them political education. They were helping them with their homework. They were feeding them like filling meals that were culturally appropriate. They were getting the community together to donate the food, so the community knows what's going on. They were pretty much involving them in this worldview. And that is what made the breakfast program so powerful, but also such a threat to the white power structure. So this is a great quote by Fred Hampton. I won't read it all, but I love the end. Honey, if you keep on changing, before you know it, they're endorsing it, they're participating it, and supporting socialism. They're supporting this new worldview that the Panthers were thinking of. And I want to circle back to this, what Anastasia was saying about the coalition building of Shirley Chisholm, because that is why Fred Hampton, who was assassinated, was targeted, in great part because he was building a rainbow coalition, and that was seen so, you know, to be so threatening. So Hoover had his eye on the Panthers for a long time, and this memo is relatively well known. That red part at the end is what's a little bit sometimes misrepresented, where it really was the breakfast program that was so targeted, where they would confiscate food for kids, they would urinate on it, they would destroy it because they wanted to get rid of it, because they understood that feeding kids was such a powerful means to getting the community to understand their worldview and to get them to support the Panthers. So ultimately, as folks know that the Panthers, they were so idealistic. And I think you had to be that idealistic to do what they did with, like, well, local law enforcement, federal law enforcement are fighting against you, the media. But they still had this great legacy, even though they kind of slowly, in some ways, they slowly lost, you know, the fire behind them. But also because of what Hoover was doing with the Panther 21, which is a large effort to falsely accuse people in New York, splintered the party. They ended up also being found not guilty. So that splintered the party. That took a lot of resources away. But still, their legacy is so profound. So they campaigned for Shirley Chisholm, which I was told that perhaps she did not help create what would become SNAP. You know, it's research is hard. I really did find multiple sources that was saying that she did do this, but she obviously did many wonderful things, as we heard. Cleo and other Panthers were on the vanguard of these social programs. Cleo helped write the Patient Bill of Rights. They were doing community health care that is still seen as having as really the vanguard of what we should be doing. Many food justice efforts, and all of this activist mothering. And I think it really helps to show how powerful this female leadership was. Thank you.
So before we turn to audience questions, and please start getting your questions ready, we want to have a lightning round. Because obviously part of what we do here is to think about this history in terms of the present. So one lesson, 1 minute from the women you study for the struggle today. Christina, start us off.
This is the hard part, right? well, I think unfortunately a lot of the issues that Joan Little and the activists who rallied behind her and continued their activism, a lot of those issues still remain incredibly pressing, you might argue even more dire today. And we know there's police brutality. We know that there are increasing numbers of black and brown bodies in prison. There's been a slight decline, but nevertheless, the United States still remains the top, you know, incarcerator in the world in terms of per capita prisoners. On the bright side, though, there's a lot of amazing activism that's going on. And it doesn't often get national attention, but in local communities all around the country, people are doing some astounding things, and I'll just mention one quickly. It's called, it's a podcast, actually. It's called Local Ordinary Grassroots Folks, who are engaging in various kinds of projects, trying to reduce harm and also create accountability for harm in their communities. And what's amazing about the podcast is that it showcases not just successful achievements, but also things that didn't work, because often in failures there are really important lessons to be learned. And so that's just, I think, one of the things that we see this long trajectory of black women's activism. I mean, you can date it back to enslavement, and so pieces of that have been carried forward even into well into the 21st century.
Well, I appreciate that we are starting to see the dominant culture become more aware and lauding these activist mothers and this Black female leadership that, as noted, has been around for a very long time. And I do especially, I am a mom, and I appreciate this concept of motherhood finally kind of coming out of this unskilled labor and being seen as skilled labor. But I also wrote down this little tidbit of when I was interviewing Curtis Hayes Muhammad and early in my process, and he sadly died in the pandemic. I was not able to interview him again, but he told me this story that he had learned from Ella Baker that what you do, like what Robert Paris Moses did, you go to the people and you say to them, you say, how can I serve you? What is it you want from me? And he had learned that from Ella Baker, who was a leader and perhaps an activist mother of NAACP. And he told me that he was called by the Panthers a few years after Freedom Summer to go help the Panthers and kind of lead a workshop about going to the people. And that also that moment of coming together, of him teaching them kind of a more formalized way of what they were already doing, of going to the people, what can I do for you? How can I serve you? And that it's already what the Panthers were doing, and that's what the free breakfast program came out of. And I think that's a lesson for all of us.
These are such powerful examples of what's relevant now. I can't deny the inspirational part about Shirley Chisholm. She's deeply symbolic, and I think, just like with the folding chair, I think we embrace that. We say, yes, we need these figures to look at, to inspire us. And we also need to look at the nuts and bolts of her strategy. So what's underneath the symbol? Because what's underneath the symbol is this amazing politician who could pull coalition together. People said, even at the time, in 1972, when she was running for president, that she was crazy. And there was even one of Nixon's dirty tricksters published a press release on Hubert Humphrey's stationery that said that she had been found at an insane asylum, you know, speaking gibberish. But it didn't seem that far-fetched because people really thought she was crazy for running for president. I'd like to say she ran to win, but she didn't think she would win. What she wanted to do, the whole point, was to pull the coalition together, to have the folks, Black, brown, women, LGBT, anti-war, young, poor, to have all those people become this block at the convention, and then to press the nominee and press the party platform. That was her point. It didn't come together because people are people. But I still see it as a powerful lesson. It worked a little better for her on Capitol Hill. So she would work with just about anybody. Title IX, she worked with men who had daughters who were playing sports and said, don't you want your daughter to be able to participate on an equal basis? She was so good at finding common points of interest and then building coalitions around that.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, guys, we're gonna get ready for questions and answers now. Get in line. We have microphones.
Yep, in the back.
And I just want to wish all the ladies here and in the world to have a great, great woman's Her Story Month. Not thank this story, but her story, your story.
Thanks
thank
so much.
You. Thank you,
thank you.
Thank you for another great Conversations in Black Freedom Studies. I specifically wanted to thank Dr. Greene, who was one of my professors at the University of Wisconsin, who actually was my introduction to gender and the movement studies. And in that class, which was 20 years ago now, can you believe that? We read things like the Ella Baker biography. We read some of Jean and Camozzi's work. We read the Ruby Doris Smith Robinson biography, Belinda Robinette's How Long, you know, learning about Black women bridge leaders. And so 20 years later, I'm wondering to hear, I would love to hear from you all on the panel about what major contributions do you think we've gained as historians in focusing on women's and gender issues in the movement, and how do you all see your books as helping move that field along 20 years into the future?
Well, can I ask who you are?
My name is Tanisha Ford.
Oh, hi. Oh, yes, great to see you. Wow, thank you.
You go first.
Oh, okay. Well, one of the things that I didn't mention before that, unfortunately, I mean, sexual violence is still a huge issue, including and imprisoned, right? And again, I think, you know, sort of following what Anastasia was saying, I mean, I think these stories can be inspirational and also aspirational, right? They had some successes. They also had some failures. They tried to form some multiracial and cross-class coalitions. Sometimes they worked, sometimes they didn't work. There were sort of some important lessons that I think we can learn from. I don't think history offers us a blueprint, and I'm so glad that you mentioned Ella Baker, because you know, she actually used to hold events in the Schomburg Library right back in the day, and the transplanted North Carolinian who made her home in Harlem. And she talked about the power of the collective power of ordinary people working together and making change. And I think that's a really important lesson, especially today when things seem so dire and so frightening. And what's interesting, I see some links between all of our books. Shirley Chisholm was a backer of Joanne Little. She called on the Justice Department to do an investigation of women's prisons and sexual assault against women in prison. The Black Panther Party, major backers of Joanne Little. They had her, you know, come out after she was acquitted. Larry Little, who was the head of the Winston-Salem Black Panther Party, became one of the heads of the campaign, the Joanne Little Defense Campaign. So there's some interesting sort of overlaps between our books and the people that we're writing about. But I guess, you know, I mean, I guess one of the things that historians can do is to give us hope. And to, you know, Ella Baker said, you know, I don't have a blueprint. Somebody else carries on. The struggle is eternal, she says, right? And so I think that historians can offer, you know, not blueprints, but maybe some lessons about some things that worked, some things that didn't. And the important thing about people's perseverance in the face of tremendous odds, and they didn't give up, they kept on. And so maybe that can be, you know, some inspiration for us today as we face some really tough times. And it's so great to see you. Thank you.
You know, I, of course, we keep seeing these same issues as we all talk about that keep rising. You know, they have not been solved. They have not been addressed. And I think so much of how we can think about how to address them, even as we're talking about coalition building and what you know, some of our ancestors have done. And I remember something, a difference between these two women, these two stories. Eileen Quinn died in the 90s. I didn't get to talk to her, but through her daughter and through others, is that in the 60s, this movement was really, you know, learning from their ancestors, learning from the elders, and learning how to navigate this world and move forward. And I remember Cleo and others said, we wanted to break with the past. We were gonna full on revolution. And she would say, and we've done a number of conversations together in events, that I wish that we, on one hand, she said, I wish that we listened to our elders and learned from them. But on the other hand, if we had, we might not have been so idealistic. And I think that we're at a place where we can do both. You know, we can learn from those that we can stand upon their shoulders, but we can also be idealistic because we can see what idealism can get to us. So I wanna also end with hope, I think, and also amplifying the voices and stories of these women who have, two and men, who have so long been ignored.
I just wanna say that we can teach the next generation of
brilliant historians. that is one major piece. But the other thing that I've discovered is that we don't need superheroes to save us. You look at the past, we have been saving ourselves for generations.
Well, you know, I believe Cleo's first activism was, she's from Philly.
Yeah.
And American Bandstand used to be an all-white dance program.
Yep, she.
So Cleo and her girlfriend said they don't know how to dance.
You know Cleo. She doesn't know Cleo.
So they literally went down and broke onto the stage.
She did. She told me that story.
And so they desegregated American Bandstand as kids. So some of us just shooting straight from the hip.
She tells the story. She's like, they weren't going to let me on, but we wouldn't take no for an answer. Oh, she's amazing. She's spitfire.
So it's she's an all-purpose activism. who's the next voice?
Okay. Hi. So I guess this is for Christina Greene. This is a question I think that's going to touch on representation. So the women that we've talked about tonight, all of them have transitioned, I believe, except for Joanne Little. Is that correct? They're all gone, right? Except for Joanne Little. Is that correct?
They're all dead.
Yeah. Oh, Joanne Little is not dead.
She's not dead.
No,
okay.
She's not.
So,
and Cleo's not dead.
And Cleo's still Cleo's very active.
Okay. So this is a question about Joanne Little, because I was very interested in her case. I looked it up. Has she ever told her own story publicly?
No, she hasn't. She's very wary and reticent. She was wary of me, like, who's this white girl from Wisconsin coming to talk to me?
How does she feel about you telling her story publicly and her name on the cover of your book? Because I know your book is not all about her. I know it's just a chapter on her.
Yeah.
So you interviewed her.
Yes,
right?
A lot.
And so I'd like to know how she feels about you telling her story publicly instead of herself.
Right. I made it clear that it wasn't a biography, but what I was doing with her story, and she was okay with that. I was telling Kamosi before, I've made an effort to try to keep her whereabouts somewhat, people are probably gonna find her, but I was worried about that with the publication of this book. I'm not the first person to write about her. Other scholars have written about her. Yeah. And she said, oh no, it's fine, And I said, no, Joanna, especially today, right? I said, you killed a white guy in jail. And a lot of people will think that still that you got away with that, and so that's you're a little bit in danger, So I wanted to try to protect her a little bit, but
I'm getting that she does not want to tell her story publicly.
That she doesn't want to speak publicly.
Yeah, that she doesn't want that she's with her. She's alive. On Wikipedia, there's no expiration date.
Yeah.
And she's here. I mean, and this was 1974.
Yeah.
So she'd be what now, like 70 or 69? So she's young. Mm-hmm. And she has not had, she doesn't have a public profile. She has not told her story publicly. So you've interviewed her, and I'm just trying to get an idea of, you said that she said she was fine with it. So I'm just curious as to why she's not telling her own story publicly. In terms of your book and her name being on the front of your book, I'm just assuming she may be a recluse. Did you ask her how she felt about that?
She knew what the title was, and she seemed to be okay with it. Like I said, we talked a lot, over a 10-year period. When I first met her, she asked me why was I even interested in this. And I said, well, for a lot of reasons. I said, I've had people in my family who have been imprisoned and sexually assaulted, and I'm not saying I know what that's like or what your experience is like.
She told you that.
So, yeah.
So I'm asking the question because I found an article in Jet magazine where she, that she gave during her trial. And she really pushed back on the idea that she was an activist and that it was a movement. In the interview, I mean, if you can get a copy, I might have bought them all off of eBay. But she was on the cover of Jet, and she gave an interview. Right. And one of the quotes really kind of stood out to me where she says, I'm nobody's movement. But on the stage, she's being called an activist mother. So that's why I have a question about.
I didn't call her that.
Okay, no, you guys are an activist.
No.
I think you did say activist. You said activist.
No, I didn't say she was an activist. I said that she was.
You were talking about activists.
But I'm talking about the way her case inspired activists.
You didn't call her an activist.
No.
She's not an activist. Okay. Because that kind of stood out to me a little bit, too, because she was adamant about not being called an activist.
Right, right.
Yeah, unfortunately, we're running out of time now. Is there another question over here? Am I wrong?
Thank you.
Hi. My name is Anastasia. This question is for Anastasia. I like your jacket. I really liked the photos. It was a very different view of Shirley Chisholm than what I've ever seen. I used to teach school, and I was very interested in the comment you made about how there were so many children's books about Shirley Chisholm, but you didn't see, like, maybe none, or you didn't see any, like, you know, adult biographies, which I usually find to be the inverse. There's, like, all these big books, but then there's not always children's books. So I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit more about why you think there was that kind of inverse relationship between adult books on Shirley Chisholm and children's books on Shirley Chisholm. And I have like a kind of like an add-on to that question, which you may or may not be able to answer. What were people using as source material to write these children's books if there were not adult books that existed?
Right. Right.
Thank
you. Question. Oh boy. How long we got? So I think I have wondered about this myself multiple times for years. And even when I was writing, you know, it took me 15 years to write the book, and I was sure that somebody else was going to come out with another, you know, cradle to grave scholarly biography in that time, and nobody did. Barbara Winslow at Brooklyn College wrote a book targeted at undergraduates that mostly focused on the presidential campaign and earlier, but I was just flabbergasted. So what I think it comes down to is the idea that we thought we knew her, and that she was such a powerful symbol that it was almost like she shined so brightly as this symbolic figure, and we didn't actually look and see who she was. She defined some of the terms as well, and so most books about her rely on her memoirs. She wrote two, Unbought and Unbossed, and then The Good Fight. And in both of those books, she had versions of her life story that actually didn't match up with the documentary record. So I can usually tell if somebody is taking from her memoirs because it repeats the same things that actually didn't happen. So it's the symbolic nature, it's her own memoirs. There's also, we can't ignore the fact that Black women's biographies are still getting less rare, but are still quite rare. And they're seen as somehow niche or irrelevant to most people. You know, why is a Black woman's story is too specific? Why should we tell that story? And there's not going to be no market for this. And well, I think myself, a collective of Black women's biographers that includes Dr. Ford and Ashley Farmer and others, we're actually gathering later this month to talk about Black women's life writing, because there's so much there that has yet to be told, so many stories. And so I think a lot of it is just that, you know, how we know her, she's not very relevant anyway, and she already wrote a memoir, so why should we bother? Mm-hmm.
Do we have time to say something about Rosa Parks on this issue?
Well, I mean, the parallels you know, are huge, right? When I was doing the work for my book, it was incredible, right, till 2013, that there was no footnoted scholarly biography of Rosa Parks. And similar to Chisholm, there was like an avalanche of, you know, children's books and young adult books. But I think a similar thing, right? We thought we knew her. And that makes it, and then the sort of ways that who is a biographical subject. And so you become a poster, right? And so both Chisholm and Parks were a poster, but not necessarily given that kind of, and again, with Chisholm and with Parks, right? Like the hope is that there will be so many more biographies, right?
Yeah, but part of it is the Academy doesn't take women seriously, right?
Right.
That's the other piece of it, right? Is you could almost lose your job in the early days, you know, taking a bet that you're going, I'm going to do this. Maybe you might not get tenure,
right?
So to make it a serious subject is you guys are transforming that landscape.
Well, and that's what's so difficult is that, you know, one of the reasons I didn't focus my book just on Aline, and I'm so glad that it is a dual biography, is because there wasn't enough collected, and so for so long, you know, we're losing these voices of people who could be recounting the past, particularly women, and so there's less to draw from. And you know, one of my goals is to help right that wrong and to help gather as many voices as possible to persist.
I think we're getting the signal that our time is. Oh, is somebody over there? I'm sorry.
Thank you so much for your time this evening. You all talked a little bit about your personal connections to the histories and what drove you to your research. But my question has to do with the importance of interracial solidarity as well as a commitment to uplifting Black stories, in particular Black women's stories in the context of book banning, the fear of evoking white feelings, the criminalization of that. So could you just talk a little bit more about that? Mm-hmm.
In 1 minute.
Or less.
Oh, I don't know. So something I'll say briefly is that I watched Chisholm, well, through the archives and through stories, oral histories, newspapers, congressional record. She started with humanity first, and she was really gifted at. Now, she might have been just politicking, but she was very gifted at finding the humanity in other people and connecting to that. So she could do it with the crustiest Southern congressman. Well, actually, no, she didn't. That actually is a famous story. They didn't get along. But if she wanted to work with somebody, she would find some common ground, and she would kind of get there. And I think it came from an idea that everybody starts with humanity. And this comes back to writing her biography, that how human she was. She's a very multidimensional person and very complex person, and she was really able to kind of appreciate that in other people across the color line, across gender lines, region, and even politics.
Well, and I think that that line of what can I do to serve you, the people who need serving the most, is something that we need to be reminded of, particularly in this day and age of, you know, a lot of well-meaning white people, a lot of well-meaning people who want to do performative activism or think that posting on Instagram or whatever is enough. And, you know, just a reminder that you can't do what you want to do. You have to do where the need is and find out where that need is. And the only way to do that is by talking with the people. And I think that person-to-person, you know, interaction is what obviously we all know in so many ways we're losing. And I think it's a reminder to do that. And that means not staying in your neighborhood, not staying in your bubble, not staying in, you know, on whatever, online. It's actually going into these places where you have this desire to help, because even, you know, a lot of people, they say they want to help or they have these ideals, but then how do you actually go there and make it happen? You have to go person to person.
Yeah, well, we know the free breakfast program in some of the Midwest places fed hungry black and white kids.
Yeah, even there's photos from Bev Grant, who I interviewed, I'm friends with, and of here in Harlem, and there's there are multiracial kids in these photos. The Young Lords, Cleo was a part of that, which were, you know, to simplify the Puerto Rican version of the Black Panthers, and they had a lot of coalition building, and they did a lot of things, particularly around healthcare and other community initiatives, by working together. And again, that's what made them so powerful and also targeted.
Mm-hmm. I would just say briefly, I think one of the hallmarks really of the 1970s and 1980s women's anti-rape movement or movements was coalitions. You had all kinds of groups forming coalitions to work around these issues. They wouldn't necessarily want to be in the same organizations, right? But they would often come together around a Take Back the Night march, for example. So coalition politics, multiracial and sometimes cross-class coalitions were extremely important, and I think still are.
Of course, the National Welfare Rights Organization,
yes,
one of the largest women's organizations, was led by a black woman, but interracial organization. So when people keep saying it can't work, that means that we're blind to what's right sitting right in front of us. And that's the other part of this narrative, is to open it up and really talk about these things, right?
Thank you, Kamozi, for leading us through such a rousing Q&A. Thank you to the presenters for their grace, for their research, for excavating these women's lives, these women's stories, and this organizational history oftentimes, this movement history, and bringing it back to us. I mean, we're in the Schomburg, archivally rich, and it's so important to kind of stand on those sources and tell those stories. And thank you to the audience. Thank you for attending tonight's program in person. Thank you for viewing this program online. Remember that we'll be back April 4th. We'll be discussing food, life, and leisure. We've gotten a little few tidbits about food activism tonight. April 4th, Food, Life, and Leisure will be online, and we'll be featuring the work of Blair Kelly, Teresa Runciler, Bobby J. Smith, and Ava Perkis. You can see it all on blackfreedomstudies.org. So please, even if you're here today in person, share the program with someone that you know, someone that you think would be interested. And follow us online at Schomburg CBFS. And I look forward to engaging any comments you may have after. Thank you so much.
Thank you.